Hello everyone and welcome to the 1st of September, and that means it's time for a pickups video. Got a lot of stuff to get through for the month of August. They're definitely one big old stack with a lot of stuff in it for one system. But before we do any of that stuff, the first thing I have to show you is this guy. The new Golden Tee Classic Machine from Arcade 1UP. This thing is awesome. I got this last Sunday, literally 1 week ago. And I'm just going to pop it on for you for 1 second here so you guys can see this. Really awesome. Kind of been playing the shit out of it. So many things that I've said in various, like, kind of justifying myself for getting Golden Tee versus getting something else. Shut the volume off. Versus getting something else for one of these arcade classics, arcade 1UPs. But I have my reasons, including the fact that I've actually wanted one of these really, really bad when I was like 14 for my birthday. And never got one for good reason. But there's four games on it. There's Golden Tee. Basically, it's four straight years of the classic style of Golden Tee. You can see actually on the front of the cab here, it's 98, 99, 2000. And then the thing that says Golden Tee Classic, which it also says on the marquee, which you can see better now that it's not lit up. Golden Tee Classic is essentially Golden Tee 2001. But they had gone to making the Golden Tee 4, which had a lot more Golden Tee Golden Tee 3D graphics. A lot more 3D graphics on it. And so they also made one that same year that was called Golden Tee Classic with the classic graphics and just new courses. So it's really cool to have in one machine a total of 12 courses as opposed to committing to three if you got just one game for 1 year. And it's smaller. The size is actually perfect and everything. And the trackball, which was a huge selling point for me on getting like an arcade machine that you can't replicate. I just love trackballs, and trackball on that thing is so awesome. It's really cool. So enough about that, though. Some of you don't care about the Golden Tee thing, but I love it. I love that machine. It's been a great purchase so far. One of the rare times that I'll just be like, oh, I have this credit card, and I'm going to make this big purchase on my credit card, and then I'm going to pay it off, because I never, ever do that. My mom has taught me to fear using your credit card for those big purchases, even though that's kind of like what it's for. I did that, and that's, like, the first time I've ever really used a credit card for, like, a big purchase like that. It's $400, which is more than the rest of the arcade 1UPs, but, it comes with the riser that it fits on, which you really should have it for Golden Tee, because you can't really sit down playing it, you gotta stand. And also, I think the trackball was gonna increase the price on it. I'm spitballing on that, but I think that's the reason why the trackball was just gonna be more anyway. But yeah, Golden Tee, I love Golden Tee, it's great, so much fun. Couple imports to start off, not that I can really remember the last time I was playing, like, NES, like, you know, sitting down at home and playing NES, but it's a couple Famicom games that I, you know, thought were really cool. I wanted them for sure. First one is, Terra Cresta, which we did get over here. I've only seen it, like, twice, though. It's a pretty cool shooter. I thought it was a cool shooter when I got to try it out. And, it's a good amount cheaper than it is on a US cartridge, and shoot 'em ups on the Famicom, no reason not to just get that version. There's actually two baseball games in here. I'm weirdly, like, you know, super into getting baseball games, especially because you can do so many weird things with them, like you can with these two right here. This is a baseball game made by IREM that is, in fact, licensed to the movie Major League. And I looked it up when I, found out that this was a thing. And someone had written an article on it basically saying, yeah, someone made a Nintendo game based on Major League, and it's super boring. And I'm like, oh, that really sucks. Would explain why we didn't get it over here. But it was, like, dirt cheap. You know, it's cheap like all those imports are. For stuff that nobody really cares about that much, but it's going to be a good enough baseball game, and it was like a dollar and change to ship it, you know? So, I have a Famicom cartridge with the Major League Baseball with the Mohawk and sunglasses logo on it. That's good enough for me, man. And then another baseball game. This is, it, you can't tell from just the cartridge, but this is actually Battle Stadium Baseball. So I got last month, I got like the Dodgeball one that's on Super Nintendo, and they also have a soccer one. But on Famicom, there is a Battle Stadium Baseball, that series with Godzilla and Kamen Rider and Ultraman and so on. Gundam is the other one. So, again, cheap one. Seemed very cool. This, with this horrifying looking cover here. So this is a weird one. I looked it up and I was like, that sounds pretty cool, and it has this ridiculous cover, so I'll go for it. This is essentially called Mr. Vampire 2. It has some longer name than that, but I call it Mr. Vampire 2 for short, because it's the English portion of the name. And if you ever played Phantom Fighter, which is a FCI published game with a like purple label over here, it's okay. This is the sequel to that game, and that original Japanese version, as well as this one, are based on a weird horror comedy movie from Japan. So they rebranded it because we didn't need to know, you know, this is a movie called Mr. Vampire or anything like that. And they did have a sequel that did come over here. So this is essentially Phantom Fighter 2, because it's Mr. Vampire 2. And then a lot of you have probably seen this one before, even if you don't really follow import games or anything like that. This is the Namco-published Star Wars game that AVGN played, and that's not really the reason that I want it. I just, like, it's a Star Wars NES game. I would have bought it if it was the JVC game, to be honest with you, because I don't have that in any capacity. But this is the weird Namco one that's, like, super hard, and where they kind of acted like they only really got, like, half the plot of Star Wars. And it comes in the crazy gold Famicom shell cartridge, so it looks nice, and it's cool to have the Star Wars weird one that everyone kind of talks about because of the AVGN thing. Anyway, I'll finish up with the last couple imports here. There's only four more. One Game Boy Advance game. This is the Disney Sports American Football. So over here, we got it on GameCube and Game Boy Advance, pretty much all those Disney Sports games. Some of them are really good, some of them are really, really fucking bad, like skateboarding. This one, I played the GameCube thing, was pretty cool, and it seemed to be a good, cool-looking version of it on the Game Boy Advance. There's enough English in it to get you through the menus, and then it doesn't really matter when you're in the game. Obviously, like, we understand the rules of American football enough that we just play it. So yeah, a cheap one again. A lot cheaper than getting the American one. Not that the American one's expensive, but it's a cool one. Cool import to have. And one N64 game from Japan. This is one I actually, like, specifically was like, this game's not expensive, I know that, and I want it on my physical cartridge to have it. This has some weird fucking name that I could not tell you what it is. It's like Ooh-chan, Ooh-nun-nun-chan. It's a bunch of like syllables that repeat themselves a bunch of times in a row, and I can never remember exactly what it is. So I call it Irritating Stick, because that's essentially what it is. On PS1, over here we got Irritating Stick, based on the same Japanese game show thing where you guide the metal rod through the maze and try not to touch the sides, like Operation. I don't know if it's the exact same game that's on the PS1, but it's basically the same thing, same idea. It's made by Hudson. I've played it on the EverDrive before. I actually have a video I streamed of it, and it's not great, because it's really, really hard to get a good control scheme for that game with the control methods available at the time, both on PS1 and on N64. But the fact that this game exists and is a full, like, cartridge game is wild to me, and I just, you know, I definitely one that I wanted to have, because it's a very silly game, and even they even decided to make it a very silly cover. To me, I think that's a very silly looking thing. The actual game itself is like in the background, so again, a very silly thing to have, not that I could actually play it. This is a series of games that they have over in Japan where they basically have like an American facts quiz. It's called like American Quiz Udon or something like that. And just this cover is just wonderful. And I had like complete inbox and everything. Never going to be able to play it. Not a chance. But, look at it. It's an adorable looking Statue of Liberty. And it's a quiz game. Fun. And then PGA Tour Golf. Regular, plain old PGA Tour Golf, but in the really nice, Super Famicom box. So this was, like, cheaper than buying a cartridge only of the regular one. And, I actually played this just to try it out. And the whole game's in English. There's not a single Japanese character in this game, from what I can remember when I played it. They just took that ROM, threw it on a different shaped cartridge, and that was what they did. So, no issues with that. And realizing that I did actually have the Genesis cartridge for the American version of that, just a cartridge only just exactly like this, I, like, just took it to work and got rid of it, and I also picked up, in its stead, PGA European Tour, just as a cartridge only. There's, like, one golf game, 16-bit golf game from EA that I don't have now, and it's PGA Tour 96, and I think I looked it up to see, like, which one would I grab? Like, if I want to grab one of these that I don't already have, because I have PGA Tour 2 and 3 on Genesis. Like, the Genesis is largely the way to go for those games, but to get the first one on Super Famicom and have this weird thing with the box and everything, and then have 2 and 3 complete on Genesis like I do, that works out. And so I was like, well, European Tour, you're going to get all these, you know, all these courses that aren't in the other games, because those are all, like, Americanized games, or North America at the very least. And I think PGA Tour has, like, three courses in it. Like, not to be knocking a game with only three courses, Golden Tee Machine. Not that you have three courses, you have 12, but you have three for a game. It just seemed really lame, because they had a bunch of courses in all the games before that, and they... It was very much like, actually, the other game we kind of talk about. It's just a weird novelty to have the very, very late sports games on the older systems to see just what they did with them. And so you get Madden 98 for, like, I think $7 on Declutter, because they got those this handful of Genesis games every once in a while. I got Madden 98 complete for the Genesis. And it fits really nice on the shelf with my NHL 98 complete for the Genesis, which is a lot more expensive than this is. But, like, do I care largely about buying the yearly Madden games? No, not at all. Except when they're on a console I really like, or when they're in a packaging that I can appreciate. And so Madden 98 on the Genesis complete. Hell yeah, I'll take it. It's so goofy to me. And then everything else, oh no, that's not everything else. I moved this shit in a weird way. It is kind of everything else. I have one Switch game this month. It's a good one, but it's also one that I didn't really have to open except to look at what's inside. Enter the Gungeon is on physical now. And when you buy the physical, god damn it, fell out. You get this little papercraft thing. So you make a little bulletin, and you also get a soundtrack download. But I opened it up to show you the bulletin thing, because it's adorable. Enter the Gungeon. Roguelike that I actually do enjoy. I do still suck at it, but it's fun. Adorable cover. If you haven't heard of it or played it by now, definitely give it a shot, because it's really, really fun. Two PSP games. One weird one that I happen to find, like, I think at a thrift store. I replaced the cover, so that Bold Move sticker is not where actually I bought it. Marvel Trading Card Game. Not much to say about it. It's a trading card game, so yeah, I'm into it. It's made by Konami, actually, so, you know, people who make Yu-Gi-Oh! Might know what they're doing. And then this is a cool one. This is Deadhead Fred, and the best that I can really describe Deadhead Fred from what I've seen is it's kind of like they took the setting and humor of Stubbs the Zombie, and they combined it with the gimmick of Dynamite Heady, because he has, like, all these different heads with different abilities that you switch them with, and he's trying to get his real head back instead of just being a brain in a jar like Futurama. So, goofy one that I don't really see that much. Glad to have it, though. one PS1 game. This is a weird game for me. Everyone, I think, has one of those games that they played on a demo disc and they can't remember. Usually it's Intelligent Cube, from my experience. But this was a game for me that I played on a demo disc when I was a kid. I couldn't remember for the life of me what the name of it was until a couple months ago, I want to say, when I really saw it for the first time. And I was like, oh, that's that weird game that I couldn't actually figure out what the rules were for. But Activision published weird deathmatch physics rotatey thing. That seems to be kind of cool. It's very novel. The whole, like, rotating individual chambers, like, platforming, deathmatch. Pretty cool. Grab that on Declutter for a couple bucks. Really cool. So now I have that game. I have my sort of, like, what was that fucking game on that compilation disc? I believe I played either Descent or Forsaken on the same disc. And I realized what that was a lot earlier. And as a kid, could not tell you what was going on in Forsaken / Descent, whatever the fuck. A couple more portables. This is just a goofy-looking game that I was like, it's a Konami game on DS that looks... Why did they make this? Time Ace. It's a time-traveling air combat, like, air combat sim game. Sure, yeah, I'll take it. I've never seen that before. I grabbed it. And then I actually had a loose copy of a different Yu-Gi-Oh! Game, but when one popped up on Declutter for like $8, I was like, yeah, you know, I'll just have one Yu-Gi-Oh! Game and have it be a complete one. So I went for this 2009 one, and I think I had the 2010 one. It didn't really matter to me what year it was, just to have one of the later Yu-Gi-Oh! Games and see, have something that has like some of these later card mechanics that I don't fucking get. And yeah, just to have one complete. So Stardust Accelerator. No idea what that's about. I could not tell you. But I have one complete Yu-Gi-Oh! Game on the DS. Good enough for me. Probably the weakest 2D Mario, from what I've heard from most people, New Super Mario Bros. 2. But obviously, we can all imagine that's a pretty high bar, so... definitely, you know, worth getting. Finally grabbed it. And then, the thing that I got when I bought the 2DS that I got to replace the 3DS that I broke. I've had four 3DSs, by the way. I say that all the time. I've had four 3DSs. And Yo-Kai Watch came as a download with the 2DS that I bought because it was the cheapest option at the time. And I needed a 3DS of some kind. And I'd wanted to play this, and I never really got that into it. But I never expected it to go down in price very much, and it did, and they've made so many sequels, and I still never expected it. But I grabbed this for like $6 because, you know, it's a game that I'm interested in. I didn't really get into it, but it's interesting, and I wanted to have it physical. Just at least one game from that series. Two more games. Last month I showed a couple games that I got from Retro Gamer Dad on Instagram. He's a cool guy. Go follow him. And then the other two games that I got from him came in right at the beginning of the month after I made my other video. So I did also get Mickey Mania. Cool. Some shit written on the back. Don't know. Somebody wrote a really long name on the back is what it looks like. Mickey Mania. Sony ImageSoft 2D Mickey Mouse game. Still real cool. There's a bunch of versions of this game, including Sega CD one. The reason I particularly like Mickey Mania and I'm interested in it is because it really focuses on the different periods of his animation, a lot like Epic Mickey does, but this was back when it was like a 2D game. And it's still a pretty solid platformer too, so a good one to have. And then No Escape, which is, I believe, is based on a movie with Ernie Hudson in it, but I can never tell who the other people are on here. I want to say that it's Kevin Bacon and Ray Liotta, and that's Ernie Hudson. But I could be wrong about all three of those names. And those could be nobody. But I think that's what that is. No, wait. Matt, is that Matt Dillon? It might be Matt Dillon. Anyway, I think it's a movie. And I think it's with people that are famous, but you couldn't tell from this. And I've seen it being called, you know, an interesting game. I've also seen people say it's absolutely garbage. I'm gonna grab that one too. Actually, both of these games are Sony ImageSoft. Interesting. But that's it for cartridges. A couple other disc-based games to run through here. Dino Crisis 3, basically the Jason X of Dino Crisis. They're in space. And a lot of people fucking hate this game. But it's interesting enough to me that I would want to grab it. It's also an Xbox exclusive, if you're wondering, you know, what kind of Xbox games I'm getting at this point. It's like, yeah, mostly weird exclusives that they had. Dino Crisis 3. One Wii game, Poke Park 2. There's another game that is kind of in the same boat as this one that I'm going to talk about later. I, for the life of me, don't really know what goes on in these games, but they're always super popular, it seems. And there's, like, mini-games and shit. And it's Pokemon, though. So, worth taking a shot at for it, because I think I paid, like, $10 for that. Two PS2 games, both really, really goofy-looking pseudo-sports games. One of them is Sega Bass Fishing Duel. Because if you've never played Sega Bass Fishing, you should. And if you don't think it's good, you didn't give it a real shot. Sega Bass Fishing is so fun. And there's another PS2 version of it that I finally grabbed. There's also another Dreamcast one, but that one, the Dreamcast Sega Bass Fishing 2 is kind of expensive. So, considering I have Bass Fishing, Marine Fishing, and now Bass Fishing Duel, I don't need that just yet. But then there's also another Ratbag, this developer, weird developer, named after a Lord of the Rings orc, that do nothing but make racing games. Saturday Night Speedway, sort of a weird Demolition Derby type arcade racing game. Anything by them is kind of interesting in the sense of, like, this is weird to think that this developer tries to make a bunch of these games, but they're good at it, so. No, more power to him. I just always thought it looked, you know, ridiculous and silly. So yeah. Worth throwing in there. And now a bunch of GameCube games. So many GameCube games. I've gone absolutely insane for GameCube stuff. Not going full set. Not doing full set. There's too much. But let's start with Lost Kingdoms 2. I have the first one. Haven't really played it, but it's a From Software game. People are really into From Software. Anything that they do. And this is one of the more interesting ones that I think, for me, is actually worth buying. Matt Hoffman, Pro BMX 2. I think probably better than Dave Mira. At the very least, it's better than Dave Mira in the sense that if you've played Tony Hawk, you can really transition to a lot of the other Activision O2 games pretty easily. And I've heard that this is really good. Park Editor, Tricks, level design, all that stuff, really on point. Good stuff. One of several upgrades to the GameCube that I'm making this month, Midway Arcade Treasures 1. This is the one with a lot of their 80s stuff, so Spy Hunter, Gauntlet Joust. Kind of the one that they really, a lot of their bigger hits that they coasted on for a while, like when they did the late 90s compilations with a handful of games, or they would do those plug-and-plays, stuff like that. Like I said, Gauntlet, Defender, Paperboy Joust, Rampage, Spy Hunter, all that shit. SRS Street Racing Syndicate. Namco's weird throwing their hat in the ring on the tuning phenomenon from the Fast and the Furious movies. This one's supposed to be pretty good. Don't have a whole lot else to say about it. It's supposed to be decent, though. SRS Street Racing Syndicate. Blowout. If it was on PS2 or if it's on PS2 or Xbox, I could give a shit about Blowout. But it's on the GameCube and it's a weird, like if somebody made a really meh Metroidvania with Contra shooting and stuff like that, that's kind of what it is. It was cheap enough for me to say, on GameCube I will buy this. But I know it's not supposed to be great. Army Men Sarge's War. Such a weird game to me. After 3DO kind of died out and Army Men got acquired by Global Star. Global Star made a couple of really weird ones, including like ones you really don't see very much, like Major Malfunction, which wasn't on GameCube. It's on, like, I think it's only on Xbox. Army Men Major Malfunction. But Sarge's War is kind of the Rambo. I will say specifically, it is the Rambo 2007 to the Sarge's Heroes First Blood Part 1 and 2. It's darker, it's gritty, it's you can tell right there. Excuse me, Sarge is just like has a full like bandolier, going full akimbo with the assault rifles. He's standing in the middle of flames. It's weirdly mature tone Army Men game. Like it's kind of brutal for an Army Men game. Pretty meh shooter from what I've heard, but it's an interesting. If you've played a lot of the Army Men games and you want to see kind of what they did to it. The other Fairly Odd Parents game, I have Breaking the Rules already. Breaking the Rules. And this is Shadow Showdown. If you know one of them, you kind of know the other one. It's the Nickelodeon games that you'll see quite a few of, actually, in here. I'll say quite a few. There's three in total for Nickelodeon games this month. Die Hard Vendetta. Again, not a great shooter, but I'm very interested in this one. First of all, Die Hard's pretty cool. But this is the game that originated as Die Hard on the N64, so I'm very interested to see firsthand how this game really came out. Conflict Desert Storm. People go really crazy over these games. So there's two Desert Storm ones on PS2, GameCube, Xbox. They all released on all three. And people seem to really like not so much all the Conflict games, but specifically the Desert Storm ones. Those are the ones that people seem to have played the most. And so I finally am kind of like biting the bullet, so to speak, and I'll give this one a shot and see if it's something that I can really get into. Because I never thought that I really would want to play it because it's a squad, really tactical squad-based, kind of like Ghost Recon. But we'll see how it goes. It's about an interesting subject matter to me, too. So, Cars. Really interesting thing that I read up on this is that it's kind of like if you took like Need for Speed Underground 2, like a really solid racing game, obviously a little bit more arcadey than the like Need for Speed Undergrounds and stuff, but arcadey, accessible racing game, but also has like an open world to it. So like a kid's version of Need for Speed Underground 2 where you can drive all over the place and whatnot. Supposed to be pretty solid. I have never seen any of the Cars movies, but yeah, it's supposed to be a decent game. Call of Duty 1 and 2, so Finest Hour and Big Red 1. So the first two consoleized games. Nothing really all that special for me going into Call of Duty other than they're decent war shooters, World War II shooters, and I'd had them anyway, but I wanted them on GameCube. That's all there really is to say about that. Another example of upgrading to GameCube versions. And again, Rampage Total Destruction. Not the best Rampage game, but not the worst one either. I think they're all kind of really in the middle. But this is really interesting because it has like 30 characters in it, and they kind of go so that you don't just go side to side on 2D. You kind of go one block at a time deeper or backwards. Interesting mechanic they tried to introduce. I never really played it and was like, this is great, I'm going to keep playing. But it's a 1-4 player game, so on the GameCube, it's definitely worth having that way. It's also on PS2 and Wii. It's really, to me, is a weird combo for that. It's a GameCube, PS2, and Wii. Not one or the other for the Nintendo consoles. Pikmin. If I actually play this in the near future, it will probably be the 12th time that I've started Pikmin 1 and never gotten anywhere with it. I've always really liked Pikmin as a concept, and I've always sucked at it. But, great game. Not holding out hope that I'll find Pikmin 2 anytime soon for a price I'd want to pay for it, because, like I said, I need to actually play this and not be god-awful. And then I also have Pikmin 3 on the Wii U, which I should play too. Like I said, with PokéPark, there's another weird Pokémon spinoff here, Pokémon Channel. I remember I rented this as a kid, and I used to think it was amazing, and it was really cool. And once I finished it, like, the minute I finished it, I was like, wait a minute, that's it? You didn't do anything in this game. You kind of just watched TV, and it was like an adventure game, but an adventure game that kind of happened in front of you. You didn't really have to do that much. So really goofy. If it wasn't as cheap as it was, I would not have bought this again. But to finally kind of add another one of the Pokemon games, Pokemon spinoffs in there. These are the other two Nickelodeon games here that are seem to be getting like really popular again. People are really into these. And it's only right to have them on GameCube. So Nicktoons Unite, and I believe this is the second one, is the Volcano Island one. I might have that mixed around. It's 2005, 2006, yeah. This is the first one, and then this is the direct sequel, kind of a, like, adventure beat-em-up sort of thing. Before Nickelodeon was stuff I didn't really care that much about. So, decent stuff there. Keep going with GameCube. There's a lot of GameCube, I'm serious. Again, upgrading from a PS2 copy to a GameCube NFL Blitz 2003. I kind of didn't think I needed to, because I have NFL Blitz 2002 on there, but I think 2003 is better. So I was like, yeah, just do it on GameCube. It's the way to go. Blitz 2003, good stuff. Two Need for Speed games. The old school style arcade-y Hot Pursuit 2 specifically, and Need for Speed Underground, which... If I'm going to play one of the older Need for Speeds, like the pre-360 ones, because I have played The Run. If I'm going to play one of the older ones, it's going to be probably Underground 1 or 2. And I don't have 2 yet on the GameCube, so we'll see how that ends up. But they're all good. They're all good and they're all interesting. Another game I could care less about on anything else, specifically PS2, but on GameCube it's interesting. Smuggler's Run, War Zones, weird driving car combat stuff, and you'd think I'd be super into that, but it's just, I remember playing the first one on PS2 and not really understanding it, but it's mission-based and kind of open and everything like that, and it's published by Rockstar, but it's not a Rockstar game, obviously. We'd know it as a Rockstar game if it was. It's like State of Emergency in that way. But on GameCube, not too expensive and worth picking up. GameCube will obviously change my mind on just about any game. Like this, Shrek 2. Would not have ever bought this on anything else, but it's a weirdly GameCube-specific title. In the sense that it actually comes in right at like number 30, I believe, for the best-selling GameCube games ever. It's not great, it's not anything special, but I like Shrek. I like Shrek, so... it's interesting, and I didn't want to buy this for a long time, the past couple months, basically, because it was always super cheap. Like I said, it's in the best-selling games. It's, like, right there at, like, number 30. But it had gone up in price, and I was like, I'm not paying more than $5 for this. No way. So, I eventually kind of, I think I paid $5 for it, straight up. Just to be like, yeah, I have Shrek 2 now. Don't really care that much about the other Shrek games except for, like, Super Party, which I have on Xbox, and everyone wants that game on GameCube right now, so it's probably the way it's gonna be. Again, upgrading to a GameCube copy. Actually, that's the story for these two. Didn't actually think I was gonna do it for NBA Street Volume 2 because I had it on PS2, and I got Volume 3 for GameCube, which is the only real reason to get Volume 3 if you have Volume 2. So I now have Volume 2 and 3, and 3 has Mario, Peach, and Luigi in it. Super cool. But really, I didn't have the greatest looking copy of NBA Street 2 on my PS2, and I mean, it's one of my favorite games along with NFL Street 2, so why not have it on GameCube? I finally grabbed it for under 10 bucks on GameCube, which is nice. And then the other one is Turok, which people don't really seem to appreciate Turok Evolution very much. I think there was a lot of high hopes for it, and it was not that great. It's disappointing, but I remember even playing this one as a kid and thinking it was really cool, and it was, you know, the weapons were awesome and everything. But I understand if people got really tired of the level design in Turok, because it can be pretty draining. But going from an Xbox copy to a GameCube copy on that is good. And then finally, the last of this month's long, long list of GameCube games, WrestleMania X8. It's spelled that way, and I say X7, so I'm going to say X8. This one's not great, but the last GameCube WWE game that I need now is Day of Reckoning 1. I have 19, I have Day of Reckoning 2, and now I have X8. This is kind of like WWF Raw on the Xbox, where it's a decent game, but it lacks a lot of polish and it lacks a lot of content. I think they just tried to get it out too fast, and so they, like, if you look at the roster, it's a pretty slim roster. It has definitely more content than WWF Raw on the Xbox, for sure. But overall, 19 does a lot of more interesting stuff. Day of Reckoning have great story modes and everything like that. X8 is kind of like the... Like, X8 is down here as being, like, structurally and, like, foundationally solid. And then, like, here's all the other three. So, lots of GameCube this month. Big arcade cabinet. Cool shit all around, though. So, I get to stream some N64, some Load Runner this afternoon or this evening or sometime then. But, thank you for watching this. See you later.